before we start it. And now we start with Surah Al-Fatiha. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladhina an'amta 'alayhim غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. This surah, the first point that should be noted is, this is the first complete surah revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Before this surah, there were isolated ayat which were revealed. No complete surah was revealed to Muhammad before Surah Al-Fatiha. Five ayat in the beginning of Surah Al-Alaq. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, khalaqa al-insana min alaq. Iqra wa rabbuka al-akram, alladhi allama bil qalam, allama al-insana ma lam ya'lam. First revelation. Second, the first seven ayat of Surah Al-Noon or Surah Al-Qalam. That is the second surah of 29th part. First seven ayat. Third, the beginning of Suratul Muzzammil. Fourth, the first seven ayat again of Suratul Muddassir. And as far as many scholars have the opinion, fifth revelation was Suratul Fatiha. And it was the first surah which was revealed to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam complete. It consists of seven ayat. This number is agreed, although there is a difference in counting. Some people include Surah Ayatul Bismillah in this counting. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, ayah number one. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, ayah number two. And you know they count the last. Ghairil Siratul Lazina Anamta Alayhim, Ghairil Maghdubi Alayhim Walad Dhalin as one ayah. So the total comes to seven. But in the second opinion, and this is the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, and I also agree with this second opinion. I will let you know the reason of that later on. Ayatul Bismillah is not included in Surah Al-Fatiha. This is the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. This is actually a sign that a surah is beginning. And this is placed between all the surahs of the Quran, except one, you know. Surah At-Tawbah, it has no ayat bismillah in the beginning or before it. Rest 113 surahs of the Quran, before those surahs, this ayah has been written. It's only a sign that the next surah is beginning and the preceding has ended here. That's all. And this is not included, and most of the people don't count it every time. Anyhow, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim is not the ayah of Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Fatiha starts with Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, second ayah, Maliki Yawmiddin, third ayah, Iyaka Na'budu Wa Iyaka Nasta'in, fourth ayah, Ihdina Sirat Al-Mustaqim, fifth ayah, Sirat Al-Lazina Anamta Alayhim, separately, ayah number six, Ghairil Maghdubi Alayhim Wa Al-Dhalin, separately, ayah number seven. This is the second mode of counting. Please note that seven, this is agreed upon, that Suratul Fatiha consists of seven ayat, but the mode of counting is different. Thirdly, this surah has many names, and it was the custom, you know, with the Arab people, the thing which they liked more, they gave it more names. This surah, because this is a very important surah of the Quran, very basic surah, it has, you know, more than 50 names have been enumerated by Jalaluddin Sayyuti rahimahullah in his very famous book Al-Itqan fi Ulum al-Quran. But the most important are Al-Fatiha. Why? Fataha yaftahu means to open something. Miftah means the key to open the lock. Fataha yaftahu, to open something. Al-Fatiha, the opening surah of the Quran. So this is actually the name which is most commonly known and commonly used. And this is very meaningful, because with this Quran begins as if it is opening the Quran. The opening surah of the Quran, Al-Fatiha. But you know, Ummul Quran, Asasul Quran, there are so many names. Al-Kafiya, Al-Shafiya. There are hundreds, as I've told you, 50 names have been enumerated by Jalaluddin Sayyuti rahimahullah. So these are the different names. Then you know, there is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrated by Hazrat Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He is an Ansari Sahabi. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him the title, Aqra'u Sahaba, Aqra'uhum Ubay ibn Ka'b. Among my Sahaba, the one who is most knowledgeable about Quran is Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So there is a hadith narrated by him in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been reported to have said that this is the biggest and this is the most important surah of the Quran. And like this surah, no surah was revealed before it, neither in Torah, nor in Injil, nor in Quran itself. This is unique and this is most profound. So this is actually about its grandeur, importance, its profoundness. This hadith is very important. Then this surah is in the form of a prayer. Although it's Kalamullah, but actually, what is it? It's a prayer taught to us. We address Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to this surah. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. We are praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Only thee we shall obey and serve. And only thee we ask for help. So actually, we are addressing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to this surah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us this dua, this prayer. And that is why this is the real prayer. This is the real salah. That is why the Prophet said, La salata liman lam yaqra bis surat al-Fatiha, bi fatihatil kitab. Whosoever doesn't recite this surat al-Fatiha in his prayer, he has no prayers at all. He has not prayed at all. So actually this is an integral part of our prayer. That is why we repeat it in every rakah. The full surah is repeated in every rakah. So actually, what is the style of this surah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah has actually represented the position of a human being whose nature is non-polluted, unpolluted, unperverted, and who has the faculty of right thinking. He can reach by his own thinking and ponderance and meditation, he can reach the conclusion that there is a creator of this universe and he is Rahman and Rahim. And secondly, that we shall have to return to him for the rewards of our actions or punishments of our misdeeds. These things, you know, they are so much simple and so much known, absolutely known and apparent to the human nature that every human being who thinks in a right way, in a straight line, who has the faculty of reasoning in a straight line, who can use his logic in a very straight manner, and number two, his nature is unpolluted, unperverted, he will reach these conclusions. There is some creator. That creator is most benevolent, most compassionate, most merciful. Then he has created us. And he has produced in us a moral law, a moral sense. We know by our nature something is wrong, something is right, something is good, something is bad. When there is this knowledge, this moral law within ourselves, it cannot go unrewarded. There must be some reward. And that reward we don't find in this world. So there should be another life. So these are the basic things to which a human being, if he is good-natured, Salimul Fitrah, and if he has the right thinking, he is Salimul Aql, he will reach these conclusions. But now he has to ask for guidance. What should I do? Where should I go? What things are actually harmful for me? I don't know. I want to please you, O Allah. How should I do it? I want to worship you, O my Creator. I want to know you. I want to love you. I want to obey you. I want to please you. But how should I do it? That is actually the, you know, this is the call of the nature. And this call of the nature has been given these wordings by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they have been given to us in the form of Surah Al-Fatiha. Just as we shall find, inshallah, today, in the fourth section of Surah Al-Baqarah, that when Hazrat Adam alayhi salatu was salam committed a sin, he disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he ate the fruit of the forbidden tree, then there was in within him a sense of guilt. He wanted to apologize. He wanted to repent. He wanted to ask Allah for his forgiveness. But he didn't have the words with which, what words should I ask the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And we find in that section, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala found in him that he is now feeling guilty, he is now sorrowful, he is now sorry why I committed this mistake, he wants to apologize to me, he wants to ask my forgiveness, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him the words, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. In the same way, if we imagine a person who is right-minded, who is right-natured, good-natured person, who wants to lead a simple and right life, but he wants to know what to do and what not to do. He wants to have the guidance. Now, his ihsasat, his feelings, have been given these wordings by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din, Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'im, Ihdina Assirat al-Mustaqim, Sirat al-Lazina Anamta alayhim, Ghayr al-Maghdubi alayhim wa al-Dhalin. So these are the wordings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the feelings of a man, a good-natured man, who wants to have the guidance. So that is actually the style of this Surah Fatiha. That is why, you know, there is a hadith, very beautiful hadith, in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, rahimahullah, and it has been narrated by Hazrat Abu Huraira, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. This hadith gives us a very beautiful analysis of Surah Al-Fatiha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been reported to have said, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِسْفَيْنِ. I have divided the prayer, that is Surah Al-Fatiha, between myself and my bondsman in two halves. فَنِصْفُهَا لِي وَنِصْفُهَا لِعَبْدِي. Half of the prayer is for me, and the rest of the half is for my bondsman. وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ. And I grant for my bondsman what he has asked me. And then there is the detailed, you know, description. When a person says, إِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدُ أَلْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ يَقُولُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى حَمِدَنِي عَبْدِي. When, you know, we say, but if we say it from the depths of our hearts, not only repeating the words only, you know, parrot-like, but the actual, our feelings, when we say, أَلْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, simultaneously Allah says, حَمِدَنِي عَبْدِي, my bondsman has praised me. وَإِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدُ, and when the bondsman says, الرحمن الرحيم, الرحمن الرحيم, Allah says, يقول الله تعالى, اسمع علي عبدي, my bondsman has spoken high of me. Then when the abd says, when the bondsman says, مالك يوم الدين, يقول الله تعالى, مجدني عبدي, Allah says, my bondsman has glorified me. Now these three ayat are absolutely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the praise of Allah, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, all praise be for Allah, who is the master and the creator and the sustainer of all the worlds. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, He's benevolent, compassionate, merciful. Maliki Yawmiddin, and He is the sole authority on the day of judgment, on the day of reward. He is the sole authority. He is the master of the day of judgment. Now this is actually three ayat. They are all for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praising Allah. Now the fourth ayah, this is actually a bond, a covenant between Allah and the bondsman. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. That is why you see these three ayat, first three ayat, according to the Arabic grammar, they go to make one sentence. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin. Actually, this is one sentence. Although ayat are three, sentence is one. But in the fourth ayah, Iyaka Na'bud, it's a complete sentence. Wa Iyaka Nasta'een, another complete sentence. It is comprised of two sentences. O Allah, only Thee we worship. Only Thee we serve. Only Thee we obey. And we shall translate it into future tense also. Because in Arabic you know Fi'l-e Muzara. It includes present and future tenses both. Only Thee we worship. And only Thee we shall continue to worship. Only Thee we serve. And only Thee we will continue to serve. Only Thee we obey. And only Thee we will continue to obey. And in the same manner, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and only Thee we ask for help. And only Thee we shall ask for help. We shall not ask help. We shall not invoke any other person, any other body. We shall ask help from You and You alone. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Now this is something in between the two. First three ayat, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is when the bondsman says, according to this hadith, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَذَا مَا بَيْنَ عَبْدِي, هَذَا مَا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَال. This is between me and my bondsman. And I have granted for my bondsman what he has asked. What we have asked, إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. We want your help. He wants my help, I grant him my help. And then now the last three ayat, and that is why I told you I agree with the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa that these ayat are three, not two. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqeem. Guide us on the right path. Sirat al-lazina anamta alayh. Sentence is one. These three ayat also go to make one sentence. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqeem, sirat al-lazina anamta alayhim, ghairil maghdubi alayhim walad-dallin. According to the rules of Arabic grammar, they go to comprise only one sentence. All the ayat are, although the ayat are either two, as enumerated by a certain group, or three, as enumerated by the other people. And I am agreeing with the second opinion. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqeem. Guide us on the right path. Sirat al-lazina anamta alayhim. Path of those whom You blessed. Ghairil maghdubi alayhim walad-dallin. Who didn't have Your wrath and Your punishment. And who didn't go astray. So actually this is explaining the same thing. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. And that hadith Qudsi says, when the Abd says this, the bondsman says these words, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. Then Allah says, هَذَا لِعَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِي مَا صَال. This is for my bondsman, and I grant to my bondsman what he has asked for. So actually, I had, you know, made a diagram of a balance. A balance says, you know, that what should we call it, a stick. And then, you know, the two sides. And we have three ayat on one side. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin. And then they are attached to that central beam. And with the Iyaka Na'bud. Wa is in the between. Where you hold the balance, that is vow. And from vow, the second side of that beam. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. And with this, you know, we have these three ayat. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. Very symmetrical, very balanced. قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِصْفَيْنِ. I have divided the prayer between myself and my bondsman into two halves. نِصْفُهَا لِي وَنِصْفُهَا لِعَبْدِي. Half is for me and half is for my bondsman. وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ. And I have granted to my bondsman what he has asked for. And in the end we say, Ameen. What does it mean? O Allah, accept our request. O Allah, be it as we have requested You to do. So let it be so as we have requested You to do. So that is actually Ameen. And that is the only difference of opinion is that some people pronounce it with a loud voice, others, you know, they just pronounce it with a very low voice, but we have to say Ameen, whether Jahran or with Ikhfa, but that is agreed upon, that we must say it in the end of this Surah Al-Fatiha. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات.
الله أكبر الله أكبر.
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us or call our toll-free number 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together we can make a difference.